Stargirl Chapter 29. Coming at ya. Let's get started. She won. As she had said she would. The silver plate they gave her twinkled like a starburst in a galaxy of flashing cameras. Two TV crews watched her in lights and interviewed her backstage. Strangers mobbed her. Citizens of Phoenix gushing, telling her they'd been coming to the contest for years and never heard anything like it. School children thrust programs in her face for autographs. Every parent wanted for her a daughter, every teacher for a student. She was so happy. She was proud. She yelped and cried when she saw us. She hugged each of us in turn, and I thought she would squeeze the breath out of me. Back at the hotel, everyone already seemed to know. The doorman, the desk manager, the people in the lobby, an elevator. Suddenly, she had this magical, wonderful power. Whoever laid eyes on her smiled, and the English language dwindled to a single word repeated over and over. Congratulations! We walked, we floated, around the block to burn off our excess energy. Back at the hotel, we were invited to the nightclub, even though Susan and I were underage. We drank ginger ales and ordered jalapeno poppers, and we all danced to a country and western band while Susan's face beamed on the late news from the TV above the bar. The dance floor was the only place where she did not carry her silver plate. First thing next morning, there she was, sliding under the door in my hotel room, her picture on the front page of the Arizona Republic. I sat on the edge of my bed and stared at it, pride welling in me. I read the story. It called her speech mesmerizing, hypnotic, mysteriously touching. I pictured folded morning papers tossed from cars, landing in driveways all over Micah. We were all met for the breakfast buffet. People stared, nodded, and smiled, and silently said congratulations across the restaurant. We headed home in a two-car caravan. For a while, Susan was her usual chatty self. She put the silver plate on the front seat beside Mr. McShane. She told him it would ride next to him for 10 whole minutes, and then he could touch it all he wanted. This was his reward, she said, for telling her about MOAs. As soon as the 10 minutes was up, she took back the plate. As we drew nearer to town, the chatter subsided and finally stopped. We rode the last miles in silence. She took my hand. The nearer we came, the harder she squeezed. When we hit the outskirts of town, she turned to me and said, "Do I look okay?" I told her she looked great. She didn't seem to believe me. She held up the silver plate and studied her reflection. She turned to me again and looked at me for some time before she spoke. "I've been thinking. This is how I'm going to do it. I'm going to hold on to the plate myself, okay?" I nodded. Until they lift me on their shoulders. Then I give it to you. Understand?" I nodded. So stay next to me every second. Crowds can separate you, you know. They do that, okay?" I nodded. "Okay." Her hand was hot, sweating. We drove past the man in his driveway. He was dipping a large broom-like brush into a pail and painting the asphalt with black sealer. He was bent intently to his work in the noonday sun, and somehow I knew at that moment what would happen. I could see it. I wanted to shout to Mr. McShane, "No, don't turn! Don't go there!" But he did turn. He turned, and there was the school in front of us, and never in my life had I seen the place so empty. No banners, no people, no cars. "Probably around back," Mr. McShane said. His voice was hoarse. "Parking lot." We swung around back to the parking lot. Yes, there was a car and another car and people, three of them shading their eyes in the sun, watching us. Two of them were teachers. The other was a student, Dory Dilson. She stood apart from the teachers, alone in the black shimmering sea of asphalt. As we approached, she held up a sign, a huge cardboard sign bigger than a basketball backboard. She set the sign on the edge and propped it up, bracing herself. The red painted letters said, "Way to go, Susan. We're proud of you." The car stopped in front of it. All that was left to see Dory Dilson were two sets of fingers holding the sides of the sign. We were close enough now to see that the sign was trembling, and I knew that behind it, Dory was crying. There was no confetti, no kazoos, nothing cheered, not even a mockingbird. Whoa, serious downer, you know, you're expecting at least a few people to show up there, you know? Three people, two teachers, like, seriously, are the teachers in on this too? How do you think this is going to affect Susan? Is it going to affect her differently than it has before? You know, when people used to hate on her, she just kind of brushed it off and said, "I don't care." But now with this new personality, I wonder how she's going to take this. What do you guys think? Talk about that in your groups there. We're going to go ahead and close off here. Coming to the end, we only have, like, what, 5-6 chapters left here. And let's find out what happens next. And in the meantime, let's go ahead and close off chapter 29, moving on to chapter 30. Thanks for listening to me on YouTube, and God bless.